Hello dear students, today we will start another topic, that is modeling of biomedical signals, or sometimes we also call as biosignals. So modeling can contribute to understanding physical or physiological aspects of the related systems. We use mathematical model to represent the process or the system that generates the signal of interest. Interaction or communication with the biological system is done through biosignals. Classic examples include the knee-jerk reflex, where the input is mechanical force and the output is mechanical motion. Systems that produce an output without the need for an input stimulus like the electrical activity of the heart can be considered as biosignal sources. Now, what are biosignals? Much of the activity in biomedical engineering, be the clinical or in research, it involves the measurement, processing, analysis, display, and or generation of the signals. Signals are variation in energy that carry information. So biosignals are usually encoded into variations of electrical, chemical, mechanical energy, although in thermal energy. For communication within the body, signals are primarily encoded as variations in electrical or chemical energy. When the chemical energy is used, the encoding is usually done by varying the concentration of the chemical within a physiological compartment, for example, the concentration of a hormone in the blood. This is a typical biomedical measurement system. You can see this already. We have seen the diagram in very first lecture of introduction, that we need transducer, amplifier, then it is analog to digital signal processing. We have to convert this analog signal into digital. Then we need signal storage or buffering. And finally, we need digital signal processing. And then we use to display the results. That is a computer interface system. And we know the conversion of physiological energy to an electrical signal. That is an important step and often the first step in gathering information for clinical or the research use. This conversion task, as we know, is done by a device, which you see here is a transducer that converts energy from one form to another. And the energy that is converted by the input transducer may be generated by any physiological activity, or it may be the energy produced by an external source. Many physiological processes produce energy that can be detected directly. For example, cardiac internal pressures are usually measured using a pressure transducer. Now let's move over to the different modeling concepts of these biosignals. So first in that is parametric system modeling. Parametric modeling find the parameters for a mathematical model that describe a signal system or a process. These techniques are known, or we can say they use known information about the system to determine the model parameters. Applications of this model include speech, muscle synthesis, simulation, etc. The difference equation that gives the output of a general linear time invariant discrete time system is given, as you can see. For example, this is a ARMA, autoregressive moving average system. We'll learn this later on in more detail. So in this you can see we have the output yn that is computed by the present and past input samples, that is x of n minus l, where you can say this l is running from 0 to q, means it will include the present as well as the past input samples. And bl is the filter coefficient, we can say, and with b0 as 1. And we have a gain factor, that is g. And in that we have terms which are basically computed from the past values of the output. So you can see here that k is running from 1 to p and filter coefficients are ak. So this is a total equation which includes both the autoregressive and the moving average operation. As I mentioned, this parameter bl indicate how the present and q past samples of the input are combined in a linear manner to generate the present output sample, that is yn. And the parameters ak indicate how the past capital P samples of the output are linearly combined, because that is past output, so that will be in feedback loop to produce the current output. Again, that is yn. G is a gain factor, and P and Q determine the order of the system. The summation over X represents the moving average part of the system. As you can see, this is a moving average part. And the summation over Y, that represents the autoregressive, that is AR part of the system. So we are calling this entire system as combined autoregressive, or we can also call it as all pole modeling. We'll see this in later. And moving average or ARMA system. Now let's move over to linear prediction model. The use of the past input and output samples in computing the present output sample represents the memory of the system. The model also indicates that the present output sample may be predicted as a linear combination of the present and a few past input samples and a few past output samples. For this reason, the model is also known as the linear prediction or LP model. Now we have autoregressive modeling. So first we will discuss autoregressive modeling, then we will discuss maybe in next lecture about moving average modeling. So autoregressive modeling has applications in speech recognition and coding, system identification, modeling and recognition of sonar, radar, geophysical signals, spectral analysis. Now we'll see in this how we can obtain an autoregressive model when the input to the system that caused the given signal as its output is unknown. For this, you can see in this, the AR, the output is modeled as a linear combination of the P past values of the output and the present input sample, and it is given, as you can see, yn is equal to minus summation k is equal to 1 to p. So this p is same as p past values we have taken. So ak, y of n minus k, these are the past output values, and we have a present input value, that is xn, with a gain g. So k determines here is the order of the AR model, ak are the filter parameters, and g is the gain. Now in this, between pitch pulses, gxn is 0 and yn can only be predicted by summation of past samples. So as you can see, we have only taken the past values of the output. Depending upon the value of p, you can have minus, whole minus, a1 y of n minus 1, in addition with a2 y of n minus 2, up to ap y of n minus p. It should be noted that the model in equation 2 does we have not included in that the presence of noise. So the AR transfer function corresponding to the equation number 2 that we have seen, which was having GXN as with the past output samples, it can be written as like this: HZ is equal to G, that corresponds to the XN, or we can say XZ term in this, and we have in denominator the poles. One is for the term of YN plus summation K is equal to 1 to P AKZ minus K. Basically, we have converted that into Z domain, and then we have taken the reciprocal of YZ by XZ, that is nothing but HZ. In case of biomedical signals like EEG, the input to the system is totally unknown. This will take a very, we can say, a separate lecture on modeling EEG signals. So in that again, we will discuss about the different models. So when the input is totally unknown, then we can only approximate, predict the current sample of the output signal using its past values. So as you can see, this is the predicted value, that is only an approximate. So it is given as minus, because we are taking that input is completely unknown, so we are not taking into account in this equation Xn. So this equation number 5 is minus summation k is equal to 1 to p ak y of n minus k. Then how we can compute the error? We can also call it as the residual. It is given as yn minus the predicted or approximated value is equal to yn plus summation k is equal to 1 to p ak y of n minus k. Now the signal flow diagram of the AR model viewed as a prediction or error filter, as you can see here we have yn. Then depending upon the order, that is the P, we can have delay elements that are Z inverse, and A0, A1, A2, these are the different filter coefficients up to AP. And then we are adding all this, and finally it is subtracted from YN to produce EN. We estimate the best model by trying to minimize the mean square error between the signal sample predicted by the model and the actual measured signal sample. So we can use the least square method for that. So it is based upon the Euler-Walker equations. In the least square method, the parameters AK are obtained by minimizing the mean squared error, that is MSE, with respect to all of the parameters, that is AK. So the total squared error is given as this epsilon is equal to summation for all values of n, that is squared error E square n is equal to summation over n whole square for yn plus summation k is equal to 1 to p AK y of n minus k, that is equation number 7, as you can see here. Although the range of the summation in this equation is important, we may minimize epsilon, or we can say the total squared error, without specifying the range for the time being. Minimization of epsilon or error is performed by applying the conditions, as you can see, curly epsilon by curly AK. We are taking with respect to all the filter parameters that should be equal to 0 for the range of K as 1 to P. So this equation number 7, if we keep in place of epsilon, if we differentiate with respect to AK, so we'll get summation twice whole YN plus summation K is equal to 1 to P AK Y of N minus K into Y of N minus I is equal to 0. So it can also be written like this, as you can see, summation for all n yn y of n minus I plus double summation 1 is over n, other is for k, k is running from 1 to p ak y of n minus k y of n minus I is equal to 0, And further, it can be written like this. We can change the order of summation. So by taking this summation over n inside and bringing that summation over k outside, we can write the equation like this. So that is finally becomes summation k is equal to 1 to p a k summation over n y of n minus k y of n minus I is equal to minus summation over n y of n minus I with I ranging in 1 to p. So here y of n minus I is a signal sample I time periods prior to the current sample at n. For a given signal yn, equation 9 provides a set of p equations in the p unknown ak, that is k running from 1 to p. These are known as the normal equations. Now by expanding equation number 7 and using the relationship what we have used derived in equation number 9, the minimum total squared error, that is epsilon p, or we can say prediction error, for the model of order p is obtained, as you can see in equation number 10. So that is summation over n y square n plus summation over k and k running from 1 to p ak summation over n y of n minus k, equation number 10. Now we have another method, that is autocorrelation method. If the range of summation in equation number 7 and 9 is specified to be minus infinity to plus infinity, then the error is minimized over an infinite duration. And we have equation, you can see this phi y here represents the autocorrelation function of the output yn. So it is given as summation n is equal to minus infinity to n minus 1 minus I yn y of n minus I. In practice, the signal yn will be available only over a finite interval, say n range from 0 to n minus 1. The given signal may then be assumed to be 0 outside this range and treated as a windowed version of the true signal. Then this autocorrelation function can be expressed, as you can see, we are keeping this n equal to minus infinity to n minus 1 minus I yn y of n minus I, but here now you can see this I is greater than equal to 0. Now equations 7 and 9 shows that the least square method is related with autocorrelation method, and this relation, as we can see given in equation number 3, the normal equations can become summation k equal to 1 to p ak phi y I minus k is equal to minus phi y I. Here a is, or I can say I is in the range of 1 to p. We now see that an AR model may be derived for a signal with the knowledge of only its autocorrelation function, and the signal samples themselves are not at all required. So the minimum total squared error is then given by, you can see, phi y 0 plus summation k equal to 1 to p ak phi y k. That is equation number 14. Now we have another method, that is the covariance method. In deriving the autocorrelation method, the range of summation of the prediction error in equation 7 and 9 was specified to be minus infinity to plus infinity. If instead we specify the range of summation to be a finite interval, say n ranging from 0 to n minus 1, we get summation k equal to 1 to p ak capital C, that represents the covariance ki, is equal to minus c 0 comma I. Again, I in this range is 1 to p. Now, instead of equation number 13, which was based upon the autocorrelation function, and the minimum total squared error is then given in terms of covariance as C00 plus summation k equal to 1 to p ak C0k. That is equation number 16. Now, instead of equation number 14, we can have Cik as summation n equal to 0 to n minus 1, y of n minus I, y of n minus k, that is equation number 17, and it is the covariance of the y signal yn in the specified interval. So this is how we can compute the covariance of the signal. So the matrix formed by the covariance function is symmetric. As you can see that you can assume, or you can also derive this one, that Cik will be equal to Cki. However, the elements along each diagonal will not be equal, as Ci plus 1 comma k plus 1 is equal to Ci comma k plus y minus I minus 1 into y minus k minus 1 minus y n minus 1 minus I into y n minus 1 minus k. So computation of the covariance coefficients also require yn to be known for the range of minus p to capital N minus 1. The distinctions appear as the specified interval of summation, that is the error minimization, tends to infinity. Now, how we can apply to these methods to the random signals? If the signal yn is a sample of a random process, the error en is also a sample of a random process. Then we can use expectation operator to obtain the minimum mean square error. As you can see, previously we have taken e square n, but now because of a random process, we are taking expectation operator, that is capital E. So it can be given as the expectation operator yn plus summation k equal to 1 to p ak y n minus k whole square. That is equation number 18. Now applying the condition, that is curly epsilon by curly ak, we get the normal equation as summation k equal to 1 to p ak expectation y of n minus k into y of n minus I is equal to minus e, again means expectation, yn y of n minus I with I ranging from 1 to p. And the minimum mean squared error is calculated, as you can see, expectation y square n plus summation k is equal to 1 to p ak expectation yn y of n minus k. Now we'll see how we can compute the gain factor, that is capital G. As we have assumed earlier that the input to the system being modeled is unknown, the gain parameter capital G is not important. Regardless, the derivation of G demonstrates a few important points. So equation number 6 we can write as yn is equal to minus summation k is equal to 1 to p ak y of n minus k, and in place of gxn we have written this en. This condition indicates that the input signal is proportional to the error of prediction when the estimated model parameters are equal to the real system parameters. In the case when xn is equal to delta n, we have yn will be nothing but the impulse response, that is hn, at the output. So hn is equal to summation k is equal to 1 to p ak h of n minus k with the negative sign plus g delta n. That is, now we have kept xn in place of delta n, so the yn will be now hn, that is the impulse response. Now, if we multiply both the sides of the expression with h of n minus I, and assuming and we sum all this over n, we get expression in terms of autocorrelation function, that is phi h I of h n. So we can write it as phi h I, which is minus summation k equal to 1 to p a k phi h I minus k, and mod of I running from 1 to infinity. And also phi h 0 equal to minus summation k equal to 1 to p a k phi h k plus g square. Due to the condition that the energy of the output of the system be equal to that of y n, the condition phi h 0 is equal to phi y 0 must be satisfied. Now if we compare equation number 23 and 13, we can have phi h I is nothing but phi y I for mod of I running or lying between 0 to p. Means in that interval, that impulse autocorrelation for factor h will be equal to the autocorrelation for the factor y. Therefore, for a module of order p, the first p plus 1 autocorrelation function terms of the impulse response hn must be equal to the corresponding autocorrelation function terms of the signal yn, which is being modeled. So it follows from these equations 21, 22 and 14 that g square is nothing but the predicted error, which is equal to phi h 0 plus summation k equal to 1 to p a k phi y k. That is equation number 26. Now we'll see how we can compute the model parameters. For low orders of the model, equation number 13 may be solved directly. However, direct methods may not be feasible when this order, or we can say p, is large. So the equation number 13, which gives normal equations, we can write that in matrix form. As you can see, this is the square matrix, 5y0, 5y1 up to 5yp minus 1, and we have number of columns and rows, and they are multiplied with respective filter coefficients, that are a1 to ap, and they will produce negative of 5y1, 5y2, similarly up to 5yp. For real signals, the p cross p, this autocorrelation factor matrix, is symmetric, and the elements along any diagonal are identical. As you can see in this, this diagonal is nothing but 5y0, so all the diagonal elements will be the, we can say, identical. For this, a procedure known as Durbin's method or the Levinson-Durbin algorithm provides a recursive method to solve the normal equations in this equation number 27. So this procedure starts with a model of order 1, and it computes the model parameters, the error, and a secondary set of parameters, and then repeats the procedure until the model of the desired order is obtained. So this algorithm can be summarized as, so we have to initialize the model order I is equal to 0 and error epsilon 0 as 5y0. Now we have to perform the following steps recursively for I being from 1 to p. So first in this is, we have to increment the model order I and compute the ith reflection coefficient, that is represented as gamma I, as gamma I is equal to minus 1 by epsilon I minus 1 into whole 5y I plus summation j is equal to 1 to I minus 1 a I minus 1 j into 5y I minus j. So here you can see this a I minus 1 j denotes the jth model coefficient at iteration I minus 1, and the iteration index is also the recursively updated model order. Now let aij is equal to gamma 1. Then update the predictor coefficients as aij is equal to ai minus 1j plus gamma I a I minus 1 into I or I minus j, and j in this is ranging from 1 to I minus 1. Then we have to compute the error value as epsilon I is equal to 1 minus gamma I square whole epsilon I minus 1. So the final model parameters are given as AK is equal to APK, where K is ranging from 1 to P. So the Levinson-Durbin algorithm computes the model parameters for all orders up to the desired order P. As the order of the model is increased, the total squared error reduces, and hence we have this epsilon I ranging from 0 to epsilon I minus 1. The reflection coefficients may also be used to test the stability of the model, or we can say the filter being designed. So that is, all these reflection coefficients gamma I should be less than 1 for I ranging from 1 to P is the required condition for stability of the model of order P. Now let's have one example of this Levinson-Durbin algorithm. So this is 2 cross 2 matrix, autocorrelation matrix. You can see 5 by 0, 5 by 0, 5 by 1, 5 by 1, diagonal elements are identical. Because this is of a 2 cross 2, we have two filter coefficients, A1, A2, and that we give as minus 5 by 1 and 5 by 2. Now we have to calculate the parameters A1 and A2. So first you will assume that epsilon naught is nothing but 5 by 0. Then we have to calculate filter coefficient, reflection coefficient gamma 1, that is minus 5 by 1 by 5 by 0. So from that you will obtain A11, that is reflection coefficient gamma 1. From that you can calculate epsilon 1, that is 1 minus gamma 1 square into E naught or epsilon naught. So in this you will keep the value of gamma 1, and we know that epsilon 0 or epsilon naught is nothing but 5 by 0. So you have kept these values, and from this you can calculate this epsilon 1. Now we have to obtain the second reflection coefficient, that is gamma 2. So we have to use this equation, minus 5 by 2 minus A11 5 by 1 by epsilon 1. From keeping the respective values, you can obtain this equation to calculate gamma 2, which is nothing but A22. So now next parameters, that is A21, how we can calculate. So A21 is nothing but A11 plus gamma 2 A11. So keeping all the respective values, we can calculate this A21. So we have obtained this A1, A2 as A21 and A22. These are the filter parameters. So this was all in this lecture. For this, you can refer the book Rangaraj M. Rangayan, Biomedical Signal Analysis, A Case Study Approach. So for now, thank you so much. In next lecture, we will discuss about the moving average modeling, and then we will specify the modeling concepts for EEG signals. So thank you.